Welcome back to this special edition of NCBA's Cattleman to Cattleman. We're talking about the importance of investing in a good nutritional program for your cattle with cattle producers and several experts from Purina. Let's get back to our discussion. Dr. Scott, I want to begin with you. You all bring dozens of new products to the market. I'm interested to know, how do you determine where to spend your R&D dollars?
Well, that's a great question and something that's a big focus of ours. And the reason why I say that is that we have to research and figure out when we're going to launch the next product. So we have a pipeline that we work with. And for us, research basically is innovative product development. So we have to have innovation or ideas. And where do they come from? Well, a lot of our ideas come from the problems and challenges that cattlemen have. So we get ideas from producers like Ben and dealers like JD, and we try to solve those problems. And there are different problems all across the U.S. because of the different management styles that are out there. And so it's our job to figure out how can we solve these issues that are there with the programs that we have. And other ideas that we have come from our sales force. Mm-hmm. They're very knowledgeable. And also our technical folks, people like Ted Perry, who was on Monday Night Live last night, and our other research team members, and our consultants in the field. And from a scientific standpoint, that's where a lot of our ideas come from, is from our internal scientific staff. And then the other thing that we've added to it is professional market research, which has really helped.
And Rod, you do a lot of that market research in your department.
Well, that's correct, yeah. We really want to make sure that we have our finger on the pulse of the producer out there, because that's where it all starts. I mean, it's got to start with that producer and what the issues that they're facing, because we know that they have to remain profitable for us, for Dr. Scott and I to have a job. And we also take advantage of one of the marketing tools that we have. From an education standpoint, we'll have about 5 different events a year back at the research farm. Yeah. Where we invite dealers and producers to come back and see what we're doing, learn some stuff about how they can manage their herds better. And we take advantage of that from the standpoint of, you know, we'll have a couple hundred cattlemen in there. Mm-hmm. From 25 to 30 states. So as a marketing guy, I'm like quizzing them all the time about, you know, what are some of your needs? What's important to you? And we've really discovered some really important needs that they had that wound up being part of the product development just from having those folks in there.
And Ben, you were saying earlier that you actually participated in one of those producer tours of Gray Summit. Tell us your perspective.
Yes, Kevin. Last year in January, we participated in one of the visits at Gray Summit, and it was an incredible visit, and I would encourage any producer that can get to Gray Summit to go to Gray Summit, because that's really when you can see what happens on the ground. Mm-hmm. You get to see the research, the science, and you can see the passion that the Purina people are putting into their product. They really do a good job. Also, I think the fact that the longevity of the people that work at Gray Summit, they've been there for a long time, it's very important to them. And that's important to me as someone who wants to purchase their product. That gave me a lot of confidence in their product, and it was a wonderful visit that we had there at Gray Summit.
Dr. Scott, so we've identified a need, be it through formal market research or an idea one of your staff members has. Tell me now about the research process itself.
Well, we have different stages that we go through, and the first stage is more or less a pass-fail. We stir something up based on what we're trying to solve, obviously, and put it in front of cattle. If they don't eat it, we're dead. Because the palatability and intake is the most critical thing. And mm-hmm. and really, if you look at digestion, you know, we're talking about ruminants. Mm-hmm. You always think, well, the rumen's the most important thing. But it may be that the mouth is the most important thing, because mm-hmm. if they don't eat it, then it's not going to go to the rumen. Mm-hmm. So a lot of that work goes into the behind-the-scenes mm-hmm. stuff before we ever get out there. So the first step that we have is put it in front of the cattle and see if they eat it. If that works, then we have a full-blown study where it's more or less what we call feed them and weigh them, find out what kind of conversions we get and added gain and those sorts of things. And then we'll have to do that a few times to get the right balance of nutrients in the entire diet and repeat it and make sure that it's repeatable, because if it's not, then we don't have anything to market, because we don't know what to tell a customer what to expect. Mm-hmm. So if it looks good, then we'll go out and do some field testing with ranchers or feed yards, mm-hmm. and we'll pool that information. And in some cases, if it's not working the way it did back home, we have to take it back home and fix it and then go back out. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we have to kill a product because it didn't work. So if it gets through that process, then we've got the opportunity to go ahead and market it. Sometimes we'll do a local market in an area to get our hands around mm-hmm. A new product, because some of the things that we invent are so unique that internally we still have to learn how to market those, position them, get our management straightened out. Mm-hmm. And that's all part of the field testing, but also an area market test is good for us too. In other cases, then we'll have a national launch to go along with it. So there's a whole process that we go through, and there's a pass-fail all throughout it. But the bottom line is that when we're done, we can go out and give our dealers, our sales force, something that is reliable, that they can say, hey, this is how it's going to perform.
I know you've invested heavily in your research department at Purina. Tell us about some of the unique capabilities. What sets you apart from other companies relative to your research capabilities?
Yeah. Well, the first thing we have is our people.
Yeah.
And so we have employees out there that have worked a long time. They understand the importance of dotting every I and crossing every T, because in research there's no room for error. And we've got specific facilities that other places don't have. So, for example, we have a metabolism unit that we call the large animal metabolism unit, and there we can look at site and extent of digestion. We can do in vitro studies, which is test tube studies. So you take rumen fluid from a cow and then incubate different feeds in a test tube with the rumen fluid and then check digestion that way. We can also take what are called Dacron bags and put samples in a Dacron bag, incubate those in a rumen, and also look at digestion. So little things like that allow us to learn a lot about what's going on in the rumen so that we can understand where we might be missing some nutrients and maybe more importantly, how our products perform. So that's a unique capability for us, and it really helps us to cut out some of the field testing, because we know what's going on inside the cattle.
Sure.
And I like to tell people that if it's a lot like weaning weight, you can't change weaning weight unless you know what it is to begin with. Well, it's the same way with digestion and nutrient requirements. We can't change them unless we know where those nutrients are being digested. So that really gives us a nice edge.
Well, tell us about some of the key discoveries you've made through the Gray Summit.
Well, probably the most interesting one that people find interesting is our work around intake. And there's two areas of intake. One is palatability, and I think another one might be called anti-palatability. And so with palatability, we know it's so important that animals, particularly in this case cattle, need to eat what you put in front of them. When you look at anti-palatability, you think, oh, that's the worst thing in the world. But from that, we've been able to develop what we call intake modifiers, which modify how cattle approach a bunk or a self-feeder. And in so doing, we've made cattle more efficient. It's a really neat project, and on the human side, we've caught on to it. And the reason why I say that is that, you know, a lot of the nutritionists, human dietitians, have shown that there's a big benefit of people being able to eat throughout the day. So that you don't have these cravings at your big meals. So it keeps your blood glucose levels more consistent. So what we've been doing for many years is we've developed snack eating in cattle through what we call our intake modifying technology. So the cattle eat a little bit, walk away, and come back and we'll eat later. And so that allows for a more consistent digestion in the rumen, and we found it makes it more efficient.
Give me some examples of maybe some products that you've introduced over the last couple of years as a result of your research.
Yeah, well, a good tie into that would be our wind and rain mineral. 2 years ago, we launched an improved formulation that improved the consistency of how cows eat mineral. And so we learned this through palatability. We knew our ranchers always had concerns, you know, are my cows eating the right amount of mineral? Does every cow eat the same amount of mineral? And so we headed down that road to find that out. And as you might guess, not every cow eats the same amount of mineral. So what we were able to do is to modify our formulation and we found out that we've got, if you separate cow consumption of mineral into two different, or three areas, you got those that are eating at the target, you got some that are eating more than the target, and then you got some that aren't eating a whole lot at all. Mm-hmm. What we were able to do was increase those low intake consumers to get them closer to the target. So when we did that, we'd think, well, does that mean the higher consumers are going to overconsume? Mm. But they didn't. They just ate a little bit more. So we were able to reduce the variation on consumption of mineral. Then we scaled up into the pasture situation and found out that weekly consumption from within a pasture, where there was less variation or more consistent consumption with our new formulation. So we launched that 2 years ago. Another product for starting cattle was Precon 5. And the neat thing about Precon 5 that we found is that, you know, all these years have been doing a lot of work on intake modifiers. Well, we've also found things that improve palatability. Hmm. And so that's what we worked with Precon 5. And we balanced Precon 5 so that we could increase the intake and digestion of forage, get some missing nutrients for starting cattle, some things like Avela 4 in there for the right trace mineral balance. We added some Diamond V yeast in there to help fermentation. And that whole combination we put together, we compared it to preconditioning receiving chow, which was launched back in 1968. And a lot of people know about it. The key thing on it is cattle love to eat it. Mm. Well, our comparison showed that cattle like Precon 5 more than preconditioning receiving chow.
Wow.
So it's very palatable. We compared it to commodities, which a lot of folks who want to feed around 5 pounds will feed 5 pounds of commodities. Mm-hmm. And it did very well. And the cattle gained 1.5-2 pounds more a day on Precon 5. And that all is because of the right balance of nutrients, and they eat more forage and get more digestion out of the grass.
That's outstanding. JD, you were saying earlier that you've actually had some customers try Precon 5. Tell us your experience.
Absolutely. You know, for our producers, it's a crucial time, weaning calves and a scary time at the same time. Mm-hmm. Them calves are going out on their own, and it's definitely a product. Cattle eat it, and they love it, and do very well on it. It's been huge for us and our producers. You know, to give them cattle that extra boost to be more successful when they get to that starter ration at the feedlot, to help keep them healthy and react to maybe some of the drug programs that we are going to start those cattle off on. Mm. And it's an easy product. It's a really easy product for producers to feed, you know, 5 pounds per head per day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so if it's not difficult for the producer and it's not difficult for the calf, sure, it's a successful product, really is.
Ben, have you had some personal experience with that as well?
Yes, I have, Kevin. With my confidence in the mineral nutrition side with Purina, I went ahead and we tried the Precon 5 this fall, and we usually will take 20 to 25 bull calves that we develop for ourselves and some neighbors around the area, and we started them on the Precon 5. And as JD said, that is a critical time. You know, when as we wean, we're, you know, trying to keep sickness away, and the cattle did really well. Those bull calves, they just took off. They never missed a beat. Mm. And as we transferred them into a finishing lot, or development lot, away from the ranch, they never missed a beat. They just kept on gaining. So we were very happy with the product, Precon 5.
That's outstanding. Purina's dedication to excellent research is a visible component in its products. Hear what producers from around the country are saying.
Increase weaning weights, increased conception. The cattle hold their condition a lot better all throughout the whole year. And it's a very predictable product. We know how much the cattle will eat and what it takes for them to gain a pound. And My Purina dealer comes out with a truck and a tank and fills them up for me, and keeps tabs on when they need to be refilled, and documents everything. And we know in every pasture what the consumption rate is, and it's really been profitable for us. The cattle, you know, eat no more than they have to, and eat only when they have to. So it's been a real good product for us.
All the testing, all the research that's involved on Purina's part, and everything that they do to provide the best quality of feed for the cattlemen. We felt that with all the research that they put into the product, that they knew exactly what the cattle needed and what it would do, and it has proven to do that. It provides optimum nutrition, ease of delivery. The cattle like the product. We don't ever have them go off feed. With the research that Purina puts into the product, we see it in our cattle. It does make a difference that we can see day in and day out.
We're going to talk about one of the most recent results of new product development from the Purina Research Farm, the new Wind and Rain Storm Mineral. Dr. Scott, tell us a little bit about how you've used this research process to develop this new exciting product.
Well, the interesting thing about this technology is it's something that we came up with ourselves, with our friends from what we call process research. So we have some engineers, grain scientist type guys with manufacturing type degrees who take our ideas and try to get those out of the plant into a truck and into cattle. Mm-hmm. So we use their help in this, along with our nutrition background, to try to solve a concern, and that is how can we reduce the waste that mm-hmm. you have when you have a bagged mineral out there. Mm-hmm. So Storm is our improved version of Wind and Rain mineral, mm-hmm. and it's more resistant to the elements. And so we worked on it. The neat thing is we were able to come out with it quicker than we had anticipated. That's because the things that we tried were so remarkably mm-hmm. Evident. We like to say it was a difference that you can see. It was just obvious. And so we pursued it very, very rapidly. Mm-hmm. And in so doing, what we did, we checked it at Gray Summit to make sure that we had the improvement in how it would resist weather. Mm-hmm. The other thing is the cows have to eat it, mm-hmm. and they have to eat it consistently. So we had no difference compared to how we were with our improved, more consistent consumption of Wind and Rain mineral. So that was a good thing. And then the next phase that we have is field testing. Mm-hmm. And so we went out and we field tested it in 10 different states with 25 different ranchers and ranches and farms. Mm-hmm. And we found out that they loved it, and they said, well, there's a difference you can see. Hmm. And so we pulled all that information together, and it looked great. And then the other aspect of it is... there's always a question, you know, if it resists water, is it going to resist digestion? So because of the large animal metabolism unit, where we can look at the mineral mm-hmm. In the rumen and look at site and extent of digestion and can do some things at the small intestine level in the rumen, we have no concerns about that. So it's very digestible. So we went ahead and have launched it.
That's outstanding. Now, Rod, you mentioned earlier that you get to talk directly with a lot of producers. What are they telling you about the product?
They're really excited about it. Like Dr. Scott said, when we went out on that field test, you know, the biggest question was that we got back is, when can I get this stuff? You know, when is it going to be available? And that was a challenge for us because, you know, it does, our process research guys put some things together, and so we have to make some modifications at our plants and some of those kinds of things. So it's taking a little bit longer to roll it out. But I really think that they're excited about it because I think they get it now. And what I mean by that is, you know, I think it was sometime after the turn of the century, which kind of sounds like Grandpa talking back at the turn of the century.
But, 2000.
Yeah, but way back in 2000. But shortly after that, I saw, you know, a NAM study that said that probably about 35% of the herds out there don't get a good balanced nutrition program. Yeah. And I think we're changing that. I think they get it now. I think the producers understand that, you know, mineral nutrition is key to those really important economic factors. Mm-hmm. You know, it really supports things like better reproduction, better herd health. So they know they have to have something out there. I mean, they understand that it's got to get in the cow, mm-hmm. and they need to have those benefits because, particularly with today's markets, yeah. I mean, if you can get more calves, you know, born earlier in the season that are healthier, you know, there's a big payoff at the end of that.
Well, I was going to say, so what you're really talking about is finding a way to get a greater return on the nutritional investment that we all make.
Exactly.
Is that right?
Exactly. You know, so as they look at a product, some of the things that Dr. Scott talked about, you know, it's got to be palatable. We've got to make sure that they eat it. They need to eat it about the amount that they need to, you know, and they've done a great job on the consistent intake. That was that really surprised a lot of us when they narrowed up that gap. But they maintained that, and then they reduced the waste by, you know, having it more resistant to water. So it's more likely that more of their mineral investment will go through that cow so they get those benefits that they're talking about. It's not blown out of the feeder. It's not spoiled. It's not refused by some of the cattle. So, yeah, it's getting the most out of their mineral investment.
It sounds like an exciting product. Up next, we'll put wind and rain storm to work. Stay with us.